Hello and welcome to 5 Minutes of Postgres. My name is Lucas, and today we're going to talk about horizontal sharding at Figma and how it differs from alternative approaches taken by companies such as Notion, as well as the Citus extension for Postgres. In this post by Sammy Steele, who leads the database team at Figma that has implemented this change, she describes how they've scaled 100x over the last 4 years. Back in 2020, they were running on AWS's largest physical RDS instance. They had moved to an R5 24x large, if I recall correctly. And then by 2022, they essentially scaled out to distributed architecture, where they split out different logical parts of the application, like files or organization, into different vertical partitions, each residing on a different database server. That helped them maintain the growth whilst the team was building this horizontal sharding solution. Now, the motivation for going to a horizontal sharded setup is that some of their tables contain several terabytes of data and billions of rows. And that became a problem on a single database server because they kept seeing issues with Postgres vacuum keeping out on a very large table. They had a lot of I/O that exceeded the IOPS that AWS could support on a single database server. And so they couldn't essentially solve this anymore because a single table of the same data was too large. Now, of course, sometimes people bring up, why are you not using CockroachDB or Yugabyte or Spanner or other databases? And I think one of the main motivations that they had here is they wanted to stay on what they know works well, which is RDS Postgres, and they didn't want to have a big migration. So the big risk here, of course, is if you move a huge database like they have, things go wrong. Data is expensive to move, it's hard to do rel, and even though performance might look good for certain workloads you're testing, the tail latencies are sometimes harder to assess. And so they knew how to manage Postgres, it just had too much data as a whole. So I'm actually a big subscriber to not unnecessarily switching databases if you can make Postgres work, because these days we have enough tooling around Postgres that we can scale Postgres way beyond what was possible previously. Now, they did identify a couple of challenges that I think some of them are still working on, but for example, certain SQL queries become inefficient or impossible to support. Sometimes SQL queries are complicated. They access data across multiple users, for example, and so these things need special care. You, of course, also need to make sure your application code can route to the correct shards correctly. And if you make schema changes, you must coordinate them across all your shards. Also, transactions can span multiple shards. Postgres has two-phase transactions to help with this, but you do need to orchestrate them. And so if you have multiple Postgres servers that are trying to commit the same transaction, you'll have to think about how to make sure your application is consistent. The biggest thing that I think they've done differently from what I've seen other people do is that they've actually built a proxy to handle SQL queries that are generated in the application layer, and then dynamically route the queries to the Postgres databases. We can see application layer talks to DBProxy, proxy then talks to pgbouncer, and a pgbouncer sits in front of each of these database servers. Now, my understanding is the DBProxy component they built here is currently not open source. It's tailored to their workloads also. But the idea is that they essentially read the SQL queries that are coming in, they then evaluate the query and extract which logical shard IDs they need to access based on that query's table references. And then they have a planner that maps those logical IDs to the physical database service they need to connect to. And then it also rewrites the queries to execute on the appropriate shards. They give an example here of a simple case where you're querying for a particular shard key, in this case X. This shard key X maps to a single logical shard ID, and then they identify which physical server that shard ID is located on. In this case, shard 4. The idea is that if they're rebalancing the servers, if they're moving around data, they need to make sure that their DB proxy is aware of the topology changes. Now, they've also implemented basic support for what they call setter-getter queries. Now, these are queries that would get the data from multiple shards. Best example is you're doing select star from table, but you're not including the shard key explicitly. And so the DB proxy in this case has to go across all of them and get the data. Obviously, this has a lot of complexity to it. And I imagine that this is really where, if you were to build this yourself and you had a workload where you're doing a lot of cross-shard queries, this is really hard to get right. Now, they did one more thing here, which I found an interesting technique, which is when they started rolling this out, they wanted to first validate that they're not making assumptions incorrectly. And so what they ended up doing is they ended up using views on their original database to validate that they were able to query data independently. So what they did is they created a view, and that view would imitate the sharding setup they had, rehash the shard key, and then they were saying, okay, this view only has the data of this hash function on the shard key from the minimum to the maximum range. And that way, by creating these views on the existing uncharged physical database, they were able to validate that the application didn't break when they moved to this new model. They started adopting this in September 2023, and I would say well done to the team at Figma for making this work. Now, I tried to do a quick illustration of how these setups compare. On the left side, you see Figma's setup. On the middle, you see Notion. And on the right side, you see Citus, which I'll talk about in a second. On the left side, what Figma is doing is they have the application layer. Application layer talks to DBProxy. DBProxy talks to pgbouncer, which sits in front of the database server. And then the database server executes the queries. If you have cross-shard queries, the DBProxy is responsible for making those cross-shard queries work. Figma is sharding on different keys. Sometimes they use a user ID, sometimes a file ID, or sometimes organization ID. So they essentially said that we have different use cases here, and so we don't want to shard just by one customer ID, for example. The Notion sharding setup, in a sense, is a bit simpler. We talked previously about the original blog post where they described their sharding setup, and then early last year, they actually also talked about how they've increased capacity. They are, my understanding, sharding mainly by workspace ID, as they described in the blog post. The application layer has the awareness of where to route the queries that goes to a pgbouncer and then ultimately also to an RDS Postgres. And if they have cross-shard activity, they presumably pull back that data onto the application and then the application can do the merge. Now, I briefly want to mention that Citus also exists. Citus extension for Postgres has been around for many years. The one thing I'll say about Citus is that, first of all, it's open source, so you could just start using it today without having to build your own. What happens is your application layer does talk to a database server. Postgres has a Citus extension, so if the query is on a distributed table in Postgres, then the Citus query planner gets active. Citus is also able to do cross-shard queries, and I would argue it's probably the most sophisticated of the three setups here in terms of being able to do complex cross-shard queries as well as two-phase transactions. If you don't have your own dedicated team, but you do need to scale up Postgres, I would seriously consider the Citus extension for Postgres as a starting point. Thank you so much for listening. This was 5 Minutes of Postgres. Subscribe to our YouTube channel to hear about next week's episode, and talk to you next week.